Many people, when they see my style of coding, say that I write C code in the C++ language, and that seems weird, but it is intentional, and many people do that. So today, I want to show you my style of coding that I have developed over the years, while doing game dev in C++, explain why it is like this, and I will also show you one small trick to add to your coding arsenal that will instantly make your code way more robust and maintainable. So let's go! So, C++ has many features, but I don't use most of them. And the reason is that they are either very hard to use correctly, or they don't give me any benefit. So I want to convince you with an example first, and then I'll go over my coding style. So, this is my custom implementation of a vector. So it is just like a normal C++ vector, but it has a trick to grow in O of 1. I have a video on that. And if you look at the implementation, we can see some functions here, like pushback, popback, and some equal operators. So it's okay if you don't understand everything. But right off the bat, notice that I need to manually call the destructor of the elements here. Otherwise, they won't be destructed. So that can be a nasty bug if you forget to do that. But looking at the other things, do you see any problem? Well, this equal operator was wrongly written. I wanted to reuse the operator from above, but using move here will actually make it recall itself, causing an infinite recursive function call. Whoops. And you can probably start to see the problem. With simple procedural programming, things are simple, and you can reason about your code. But the more complicated rules there are, like the fact that there is an assignment operator, an assignment of temporary variables, like you can see here, that was called from this move here, adds very subtle bugs and problems that you can just very easily miss, even after looking at them for days. And you want to hear the worst part? This code compiles, and while you could catch the bug if you were lucky to call this function, that is only called in a situation like this. Oh wait, this seems to also call the copy constructor here, and that also has a problem that I didn't catch before. Okay, I just found a bug. Okay, getting back, this could have caught my bug, but there might be other problems lurking. Like here, this line should actually have been like this, because in this way, the code will do less unnecessary constructions, and I managed to figure that out using some unit testing. And this is the problem. Unless you are a C++ guru, you can tell that this C++ is 100% correct, and that there is no C++ quirk to break it. I hope you can believe me that while trying to construct this example, I just introduced this problem here, to illustrate. And then I also found this problem with the copy constructor, and also the problem with this thing. And this is an old repo that I debugged and tested a few times over the years. And every time I look at it, I find a new problem. And trust me, I have been doing only C++ for like 10 years, I know C++. So this is why the standard implementation of a vector looks so weird, because that's the correct way to write it. I don't know about you, but I don't want to write code like that. So my strong recommendation is to write simple C++ code in your everyday coding, and do weird stuff like this only if there's no alternative. Still, don't agree with me? What do you think is harder, making a Minecraft clone or writing a C++ vector? Well, I'll tell you that I can make a Minecraft clone, but my vector that I even built unit tests for still has a problem that I just found now. You didn't expect that, did you? You saw that I was done, but no. Using memcopy here is wrong and can sometimes, and I underline sometimes, break your program. So I believe that it is great that we have std vector, and I love it, and I use it every time, but I'm not implementing something like that every day. So I sometimes like to think of C++ as C with vectors. With this in mind, let's look at my coding style, and also that trick that I promised. I like approach-based design. This means write the code first, then make abstractions. Like, how can you make abstractions if you don't know how your code will look? And then about coding itself. In general, I write most of the code procedural. If a function becomes big, like the main function, I split it in regions sometimes, then smaller functions. Also, you can see that I'm not a fan of having many very small functions. I think that makes the program harder to read actually. I just split things into functions or classes when it makes sense. I also use lambdas quite often to make some temporary functions. I don't like functional programming, but I do like not saving too much state. I instead recalculate it when I need to, so from that perspective, I write my code a little functional. On this topic, I don't use events or callbacks. I try to, again, instead ask every time if something should happen rather than wait for an event trigger. If I'm inside a boss fight, for example, I would check if the boss is alive drops to zero, instead of sending a kill boss event when it dies. I know that it might not seem like much, but things like this compound and can add weird bugs. For example, when I press Ctrl X on a folder, it will cut it, and it will make it look faded to signal that. But if I change the name of that folder, it will still remain faded, but I can't actually paste it anymore, because the name has changed. Now, Microsoft did it like this probably to save battery, but you can see how a bug was introduced. But for us, it's much simpler to just check every frame if the current cutted file is the current one, and if so, change its appearance. I also do some data-oriented design. So, for example, I like creating systems for contained things, and then pass them around as references. This makes it simple for me to see what system uses what. And you can do cool stuff by passing data around like this. Like, this is how I implemented hotkey reloading in my game engine. Check this video if you want to know how. I also prefer to write the code down, rather than have fancy abstraction systems where I can submit work. It is cool to have something like this, but you have to keep in mind that this makes them harder to debug if they interact, because I think that if you simply write the code, you can more easily see the code, read it, and step through it. For a similar reason, I don't throw exceptions. Using a procedural coding style, you can easily see and read what happens. But if you throw an exception, that's like having a goto, but a goto that jumps out of multiple functions. And not only that, but potentially, it can be thrown from many places. So depending on the case, I return error codes, or my favorite trick, but I will leave that for last. Now, to manage memory. I don't like classes to allocate memory on creation, and making use of destructors myself. If needed, my structs have a create and destroy methods. You might think it's easy to have leaks, but I already made a video about that, so you can look there. The advantage is that if I have a class that has some resources like a texture, I can easily pass it around systems and delete it at the end. Now, I also don't use polymorphism, but the reason is that I don't personally get benefits from it. And that is the case with many C++ features. So just because a feature is there, that doesn't mean you should use it. You should use it if the benefits outweigh the cost. And this applies to many things, so next time you want to do something a certain way, because that is what you see people do online, ask yourself if that will actually benefit you in any way, or it is just extra unnecessary complexity. And now, one of my best tips that I can give you, and that will improve your codebase by a lot. So imagine you have this function, and it is important the programmer will either supply no parameters here, or both of them. You could add a comment, but it's easy to not see it. Or even way worse, modify how the function works, but forget to remove this comment. Introducing asserts. Asserts are a special type of errors that are meant for the programmer to check its code. They are meant to display an error message to the programmer, to tell him that he wrote his code wrong. So you can include the assert and use the standard assert from C++. If the expression inside it is zero, it will throw this message, and it will even allow you to debug if you are in debug mode. But keep in mind that this assert will not run in release mode, and it also won't even run the code inside it, so be careful. So if you want a release assert, you can implement your own assertion function like this. And there is also static assert. This is an assertion that happens at compile time. So for example, I have this class and I did some bit manipulation magic on it, and it will break if I change its size. So I can just add a static assert here. The code won't compile if I change the size of this struct, letting me know that I also need to update the code here. So whenever you expect your program to behave in a certain way, or a variable to have a certain value, you can add an assert there. And if it is triggered, that means that you have a bug. And because you added the assert, you got lucky and managed to find it early. And if you found this assert thing interesting, subscribe because the next video is also on that topic. So think about who else codes like you, and send him this video to also help him. And check out how I manage memory. See you!